To make things easier, IFRS 16 mentioned certain types of lease transactions that are exempt from the requirement to recognize a right-of-use asset. These leases are short-term leases, and leases of low-value assets. Here the lessee has the option to either recognize a right-of-use asset, or apply the exemption and not recognize a right-of-use asset, but instead, recognize the lease payments directly as an expense in the profit and loss account. The lease payments are recognized in the profit and loss account either on a straight-line basis over the lease term, or any other systematic basis, if that basis is more representative of the pattern of the lessee's benefit. Let us start with short-term leases. A short-term lease is a lease that from the commencement date, has a lease term of 12 months or less, and does not include any purchase option. Let us see an example. ABC Quick Delivery Company leased a car from Express Trucks Company for $2,000 monthly for 2 years. Neither the lessee nor the lessor can terminate the lease agreement during the first 8 months. Only the lessee can terminate the lease agreement after 8 months from the commencement date without the lessor's consent. On the commencement date, and based on the lessee's circumstances, there is a reasonable certainty that the lessee will terminate the lease agreement. Account for this transaction on the commencement date. Here, the non-cancellable period of the lease term is 8 months. The optional period, which is the remaining 16 months, is not included in the lease term, because the two conditions for that are not satisfied. First, the lease is not enforceable during the optional period because the lessee can terminate the lease during the optional period without the lessor's consent. And second, there is a reasonable certainty that the lessee will terminate the lease during the optional period. So based on that analysis, we can say that the optional period is not included in the lease term, and the lease term is only 8 months of the non-cancellable period. Since the lease term is less than 1 year, the agreement qualifies as a short-term lease. Here the lessee has the option to either recognize a right-of-use asset, and a lease liability at the commencement date, and this is quite easy by now for you, or to recognize the lease payment directly to the profit and loss account. Note that if the lease agreement includes an option for the lessee to purchase the car by the end of the lease term, then the lease is not a short-term lease, and therefore should be accounted for by recognizing a right-of-use asset, and a lease liability. Now, what is the case if the lessee elects to apply the exemption for a short-term lease, then subsequent changes occur to these leases that make these leases do not qualify as a short-term lease. Suppose that a lessee leases a car for 6 months, this is clearly a short-term lease, and the lessee elects to apply the exemption for that lease. Then at the beginning of the 4th month, both the lessee and the lessor agree to modify the original terms and conditions of the lease, by including a purchase option in the lease, or by increasing the lease term from 6 months to 18 months. In this case, the lease after this modification is no longer a short-term lease, and the lessee should account for this lease as if it was a new lease, and recognize a right-of-use asset, and a lease liability. Note that the commencement date for this new lease is the date of modification for that lease. Well, that is all for the short-term leases. Now let us move to the second type of leases that are exempt from the requirement to recognize a right-of-use asset. These are the leases of low-value assets. A lease is considered a lease of low-value asset if the following conditions are met. The first condition. The underlying asset should have a low value when new. The age of this asset or its current value at the inception of the lease agreement is ignored. Examples of these assets are PC tablets, personal computers, small items of office furniture, and telephone sets. On the other hand, cars are not considered low-value assets, because a car would have a high value when new. The second condition. The lease is not a head lease in a sublease agreement. A lessee leases an asset from a lessor, and that lease qualifies as a lease of low value asset, and therefore, the lessee elects to apply the exemption and record the lease payments as expenses in the profit and loss account. Later during the lease term, the lessee subleased that low value asset to a third party. Here the standard says that if a lessee subleases, or expects to sublease a leased asset, then the head lease of that asset cannot qualify as a lease of a low value asset. The third condition, the lessee can benefit from the use of the underlying asset, whether that asset is used on its own, or together with other resources that are readily available to the lessee. And the fourth condition, the underlying asset is not highly dependent on, or highly interrelated with other assets. We already saw these two conditions in the third section of this course, when we talked about the separation of lease components within a contract. A company might lease an asset like, for example, an ERP system. That system is composed of several modules, where the company leases each module separately. Each module has a low value on its own when new. So instead of recognizing a right of use for the whole system, the company chooses to account for the individual leases of these modules as leases of low value assets, and thereby avoid showing liabilities on the statement of financial position. Here, the fourth condition blocks that attempt for hiding the liabilities by stating that, if these modules are highly dependent on, or highly interrelated with each other, then the individual leases cannot be accounted for as leases of low value assets. Instead, they should be accounted for as one lease for the whole system, with a right of use recognized for that system on the statement of financial position. These are the four conditions for assessing whether a lease qualifies as a lease of low value asset. Note that this assessment should be done on an absolute basis, regardless of the materiality of those leases to the lessee. In other words, the size, nature, or circumstances of the lessee are ignored in that assessment. So, let's take an example. A sports academy signed the following lease agreements with a lessor to lease the following assets: 20 used iPhone mobile and Apple watches to be used by individual athletes as a monitor for their performance. 10 PC tablets and desktop computers to be used by the admin team of the academy. The first lease agreement is not a lease of low value assets, because both the Apple watches and the mobile phones are highly interrelated, and therefore they do not qualify as a lease of low value assets. The second lease agreement is a lease of low value asset, because the conditions here are satisfied. The PC tablets and desktop computers have low values when new, and they will be used in the business of the lessee and will not be subleased to others. Also, the lessee can benefit from use of the PC tablets and desktops, and these tablets and desktops are not highly dependent on, or highly interrelated with each other. That's all for this lecture. In the next lecture, we will talk about the presentation and disclosures of lease transactions in the lessee's books.